If I like it, I'll take it down at another.
Hope everyone's doing well tonight. Okay, everyone's doing well, Karen McKee.
I'm doing well.
Don't have any.
Get my extension call.
Oh, gee.
Anybody have any news, announcements? Was it, in the newsletter Sunday or?
I just shan't call me, tell me $85.
Did Dick say any more about Joe?
It's very warm in Florida.
But he's going, they're going around these different areas, back off Tennessee and move up to.
What's the deal with the problem?
He's not saying anything important at all.
No.
He's just going on about Shan and Trudy's plans on the way back.
And I guess that's in terms of news and such right now.
Oh.
Is that it? Or did you just have your hand up?
Oh, you can't do it.
Can't hear me.
Yeah.
You can't hear.
Okay, that's a new hat.
I was gonna pick it up.
People can't hear me, that never happens.
Today has been checked, it's not just you.
Whoa.
Evidently.
No.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Yes.
Can you hear me now?
Call front row.
So today, we're just continuing our series on great chapters in the Bible, and today we're talking about Judges chapter 7. Talking about Gideon and his 300 valiant men. Not to be confused with one, my nephew Gideon, two, not to be confused with the 300 men that participated in the Battle of Thermopylae against the Persians, which takes place centuries after this. Okay. So, Gideon's 300. First off, we need to set up what's going on here. To do that, we need to jump back to Judges chapter 6, verses 1 through 10. Then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. You can see that word, find that verse multiple times in this book. So the Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian for 7 years. And the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel because of the Midianites. The children of Israel made for themselves the dens, the caves, and the strongholds, which are in the mountains. So it was whenever Israel had sown, Midianites would come up, also Amalekites, and the people of the east would come up against them. Then they would encamp against them and destroy the produce of the earth as far as Gaza, and leave no sustenance for Israel, neither sheep, nor ox, nor donkey. For they would come up with their livestock and their tents, coming in as numerous as locusts. Both they and their camels were without number, and they would enter the land to destroy it. So Israel was greatly impoverished because of the Midianites, and the children of Israel cried out to the Lord. And it came to pass, when the children of Israel cried out to the Lord because of the Midianites, that the Lord sent a prophet to the children of Israel who said to them, "Thus says the Lord God of Israel, I brought you up from Egypt and brought you out of the house of bondage. And I delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians and out of the hand of all who oppressed you, and drove them out before you and gave you their land. Also I said to you, I am the Lord your God, do not fear the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell, but you have not obeyed my voice." We're not told who that prophet is, it's just he's here and then he's gone apparently. Probably doesn't make anything difference in the long run, but pretty much, Israelite has done what they continue to do since the book of Judges begins, and that's do the exact opposite of what God told them to do. As it says several times in the book, They did what was right in their own eyes. Now, I don't know about you, but whenever I do what's right in my own eyes compared to what God wants me to do, things usually don't turn out that well.
You're no longer in that.
So, that's what's going on here in heading to Gideon. Now, before we get to Gideon's 300 men, Gideon is, to get through this chapter 6, this chapter 7, an angel speaks to Gideon. Gideon goes and destroys his father's altar to Baal, and somehow manages to not get killed by everyone that wants to kill him after that. And then Gideon decides to test God, because apparently he's not exactly convinced yet that he can get rid of the Midianites through him. So he has him say, so he tries him with him. So he says, if there's dew on the, so I'm going to put this piece on the ground, if there's dew on it, the ground's dry, good, I'll trust you, I'll believe you. Well, then the next morning it's so, and he says, well, how about let's do it the other way around, let's have the ground be dry, and let's do it the opposite way, and that happens too, and he's like, okay, I'm not going to argue with you anymore, I'm just going to listen. So, for chapter 7 now, to get to what we're coming up. Verses 1 through 7. Then Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, and all the people who were with him rose early and encamped beside the well of Herod, so that the camp of the Midianites was on the north side of them by the hill of Moreth in the valley. And the Lord said to Gideon, the people who are with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hands, lest Israel find glory for itself against me, saying, my own hand has saved me. Now therefore proclaim in the hearing of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and afraid, let him turn and depart at once from Mount Gilead. And 22,000 of the people returned, and 10,000 remained. So we're starting off here with about 32,000 people, if my math is correct. And now God says in your head, tells Gideon, tell people if they're afraid, it's okay, you can go back home, go back home. And that might sound slightly weird to us sometimes because that is strength in numbers, but if you go back to Deuteronomy chapter 20, near the end of Moses' life, it says, verses 1 through 8, when you go out to battle against your enemies and see horses and chariots and people more numerous than you, do not be afraid of them, for the Lord your God is with you, who brought you up from the land of Egypt. So it shall be when you are on the verge of battle, the priest shall approach and speak to the people. And he shall say to them, hear, O Israel, today you are on the verge of battle with your enemies. Do not let your heart faint, nor do not be afraid, and do not tremble or be terrified because of them. The Lord your God is he who goes with you to fight for you against your enemies to save you. Then the officer shall speak to the people, saying, what man is there who has built a new house and has not dedicated it? Let him go and return to his house, lest he die in the battle on another land dedicated. Also, what man is there who has planted a vineyard and has not eaten of it? Let him go and return to the house, lest he die in the battle and another man eat of it. And what man is there who is betrothed to a woman and who has not married her? Let him go and return to his house, lest he die in the battle and another man marry her. The officer shall speak further to the people and say, what man is there who is fearful and faint-hearted? Let him go and return to his house, lest the heart of his brethren faint like his heart. So, this is something I don't think you generally find in ideas for a battle strategy. Perhaps I could be wrong, I haven't studied a lot of that, but it doesn't make a lot of sense in our hearing to hear that, something like that. But here God is saying, okay, well, you don't want to fight, that's okay. Go back to your homes, go back to your families, and do what you need to do. Lest someone else do it, if you're not there. So, it says what here, how many people left now, was it?
22,000.
Yeah, 22,000 people decide that they're afraid or just don't want to fight anymore and decide to go home. So, the Lord said to Gideon, the people are still too many. Bring them down to the water and I will test them for you there. Then it will be that of whom I say to you, this one shall go with you, the same shall go with you, and of whomever I say to you, this one shall not go with you, the same shall not go. So he brought the people down to the water, and the Lord said to Gideon, everyone who laughs from the water with his tongue as a dog laughs, Likewise, everyone who gets down on his knees to drink. And the number of those who lacked, putting their hand to their mouth, was 300 men, but all the rest of the people got down on their knees to drink water. Then the Lord said to Gideon, by the 300 men who lacked, I will save you and deliver the Midianites into your hand. Let all the other people go, every man to his place. So we've gone from 32,000 people to 10,000 to 300. That's a lot of people to count. That's a lot of people. That's a lot of people who need to drink water.
Do you think there's any rhyme or reason as to why the 300 is to their posture in the drinking of the water, or is it just arbitrary?
I've never been able to make sense of it. I don't know. Anyone have any ideas on this?
At some point, I read or somebody said that if you're down on all fours, you can't see what's happening around you. But if you lap with your hand, you're in a more strategic position to protect yourself. So that God was trying to get down to the 300 who were brighter than the average bear. We never talk about the 22,000 that left, but I marvel at the people, the guys who are willing to stand up and say, I'm a coward, it's true, I'm going home. I mean, it's an amazing sentence. If you guys are afraid, it's okay, you can go ahead and leave. And 22,000 get up and leave?
And you have to remember, too, this is not a formal regulated army like we see later on, starting with King Saul from there on, where you're pretty much conscripted into service and you basically have to follow.
But still, these people have been constantly attacked. They're constantly losing everything. They're in a very weak position, and they have a chance to defend themselves. And he says, if you're not feeling it, if you're not feeling it, it's okay, just go home. And 22,000 get up and skedaddle. That, to me, says a lot about Israel's mindset at that particular point. But that just amazes me that, you know, basically three and a half out of four, something like that, get up and leave at that simple offer. That's all right. Go.
And I mean, they might not have much effect to come back to it, you know, because as I said, you know, pretty much they planned. And then before they'd have a chance to harvest, where the Midianites and everyone else would come in and just take it from them. So it's.
But then you got to think, if they were that afraid, they wouldn't be any good at battle. They'd probably be getting in the way or hiding under rocks or something. You know, people just don't follow orders.
So we're down to 300 people, maybe because of the better actions in their surroundings, maybe because, well, maybe what it's. Would be best for this upcoming. I'm not even going to call it a bad one, to be honest, because we're not much of one, but as we'll see. So the people took provisions and their trumpets in their hands, and he sent away all the rest of Israel, every man to his tent, and retained those 300 men. And the camp of Midian was below him in the valley. It happened on the same night that the Lord said to him, arise, go down against the camp. Against the camp. For I have delivered it into your hand. But if you are afraid to go down to the camp with the fury of your servant, and you shall hear what they say, and afterward your hand shall be strengthened to go down against the camp. And he went down with the fury of his servant to the outpost of the armed men who were in the camp. So I mentioned it earlier that Gideon is doesn't have that biggest amount of faith or trust in God sometimes, hence with the double fleece and things like that. Here again, God apparently knows that Gideon might not be ready and willing to just kind of saunter over where the camp is and hear what's going on without having someone with him. So he said, bring your servant, and Gideon said, okay, I can do that. So he does. Now, the Midianites and I'll read this through 14 now, yes. Now the Midianites and Amalekites, all the people of the east, were lying in the valley as numerous as locusts, and their camels were without number as the sand by the seashore in multitude. And when Gideon had come, there was a man telling a dream to his companion. He said, I have had a dream. To my surprise, a loaf of barley bread tumbled into the camp of Midian, came to a tent, and struck it so that it fell and overturned, and the tent collapsed. And his companion answered and said, This is nothing else but the sword of Gideon, the son of Joash, the man of Israel. Into his hand God has delivered Midian and the whole camp. So we wonder sometimes, we talk a lot sometimes about how God uses dreams and visions, and it's usually, you know, the people that follow, you know, like Joseph or Daniels, things like that. Here it's someone on the other side of the battlefield. And he's like, I have this dream, this vision, where this big, this local red just falls in the camp and takes out a tent and kills everyone in it. It sounds a bit ridiculous to us in some ways, but, and how he understands then that, how he understands that it's Gideon coming, getting the sword of Gideon, that's probably God's hand there, because I don't know about you, but I don't see a tumbling loaf of bread to mean anything like that. But then, what do I know? I don't know anything, so. But what also was, so the important thing here is that, so, Gideon, while he is somewhat doubting, he is obeying. So he's gone down to the camp, and what has he heard? Pretty much, what, the same thing that Joshua was told, oh, except Gideon's hearing it directly, God's going to deliver the enemy into your hands. Don't worry about the thing. And God's direction, and so Gideon's following the directions here. Good things happen when we obey God, even when we do not see it sometimes. Sometimes it takes a while, too, and Gideon's obeying. He's not turning tail, he's not saying, hey, I want to be like those, you know, 20,000 people and decide not to partake, or go to 22,000. 22,000. So, verse 15, and so it was when Gideon heard the telling of the dream and its interpretation that he worshipped. He returned to the camp of Israel and said, arise, for the Lord has delivered the camp of Midian into your hand. So usually when we get some good news or something, what's the first thing we do? Right, we celebrate. What's the first thing Gideon does?
He prays.
He prays. He worships. He gives thanks. He could have just, you know, ran back in there and said, hey, I got good news, you know, we're going to crush everybody. He's like, no, he's like, I'm going to take some time out here and worship first, then I'll go tell everyone and tell them that it's not me that's going to do it, but God's going to give us, you know, God's going to give us the victory here.
Could you imagine being one of the 300? You're looking down in the valley, and the numbers are tremendously against you. They had to have a lot of trust in God, but a lot of trust in Gideon as well, saying, hey, God has turned this over to us. He can't even count the camels. So many loaded camels.
Stephen, I have a note about the barley. Barley apparently was considered an inferior grain, about half the worth of wheat. And this makes the point that it's a fitting symbol for Israel, which was inferior in numbers.
That makes some sense there. Okay, so, let's see. Then he divided the 300 and then into three companies, and he put a trumpet into every man's hand with empty pitchers and torches inside the pitchers. And he said to them, look at me and do likewise. Watch, and when I come to the edge of the camp, you shall do as I do. When I blow the trumpet, I and all who are with me, then you also blow the trumpet on every side of the whole camp and say, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. So Gideon and the 100 men who were with him came to the outpost of the camp at the beginning of the middle watch, just as they had posted the watch. And they blew the trumpets and broke the pitchers that were in their hands. Then the three companies blew the trumpets and broke the pitchers. They held the torches in their left hands and the trumpets in their right hands were blowing. They cried, the sword of the Lord and Gideon. And every man stood in his place all around the camp, and the whole army ran and cried out and fled. When the 300 blew the trumpets, the Lord set every man's sword against his companion throughout the whole camp. And the army fled to Beth Acacia toward Zerera, as far as the border of Abel, the whole of Itab. And the men of Israel gathered together from Naphtali, Asher, and all Manasseh, and pursued the Midianites. Then Gideon sent messengers throughout all the mountains of Ephraim, saying, come down against the Midianites and seize from them the watering places as far as Beth-Ara and the Jordan. And all the men of Ephraim gathered together and seized the watering places as far as Beth-Ara and the Jordan. And they captured two princes of the Midianites, Oreb and Zeb, and they killed killed Oreb, Baraka, Oreb, and Zeb, they killed up the wine press of Zeb. They pursued Oreb and Zeb to Gideon on the other side of the Jordan. Okay, so we have some stuff to talk about now. So, what do the men not have with them when they're going down for this battle?
Weapons.
What? I mean, they got a torch, a pitcher, and a sword, and a trumpet.
That's what, all the way around, make you think there was thousands of them.
Here. Where's the swords, where's the shields, the arrows, the slings, you know, it's, they're not there. Because they don't need them. We saw in Joshua that there was a lot of times where, like in the case of Jericho, basically they didn't need any swords or weapons there either. The trumpets are a real weapon because it causes chaos in some ways. And in this case here, it's not necessarily giving an audible cue for the destruction of the walls, but it's definitely causing confusion.
The torch thing must have worked almost as a kind of a magnification. Normally, I wouldn't think every soldier would go into battle with a torch, but some would. So if you did the math and all of a sudden you saw 300 torches, you would think maybe there's got to be, you know, I don't know how many times that many soldiers, maybe, I don't know what the figure would be, but so it did carry with it a fear factor, I suppose, when they saw all of those and heard all the trumpets at once.
Yes, I think about the trumpets. Usually, my notes say, usually only a small number of men would have trumpets.
And it amazes me that the Midianites and Amalekites and stuff, they haven't really apparently sent anyone up the hill or cliff to see what was going on in Israel's camp over the last couple of days. Because you think that at some point they say, hey, we think there might be people up there, we should go see what they're doing. And they, you know, they go back and say, oh, there's only 300 of them left, you know. But apparently not. Because someone saw the barley bread and that was it. But as it says too, the Lord says in verse 21, the Lord, 22, the Lord said every man's sword against his companion. So in the chaos, God is, I don't know if he's directly doing it or indirectly, but somehow he's created enough chaos that everyone's panicking and pretty much killing the mate, killing their fellow soldiers. There's other times I think throughout the Bible where this happens too, where there's just so much chaos that, you know, people just start stacking out whatever's around them. Those cases. Any comments, questions so far? So there's a couple of things we're seeing here that we can look at here. First off, we can look at Gideon here and how he starts out with some doubt in some ways. As we said earlier on, he had, you know, did the double fleece, wanted to bring someone with him. He's not Joshua. He's not raised to be a military leader or things like that. He doesn't follow, you know, following Moses, so things are a bit different for him. He also has a lot of people that want to kill him too from the nearby cities because he confirmed his dad's altar the veil down, and people took umbrage to that. His dad didn't let everyone else in. And once again, he does that at night. He likes to do things in the night apparently because it's hard to be seen. But we're seeing here now that once he knows that the camp will be in his hand, he's getting confidence all of a sudden. Good confidence, like faithful confidence. So, and he goes and says, okay, the Lord's giving us the Midianites here, or at least, you know, a good chunk of them. Let's go down and make some noise, and that's what happens. So, one thing I've been getting out of this is that sometimes less and you've heard the saying less is more. Sometimes, you know, the simpler things make a bigger difference. This is one of those cases here because, sure, 32,000 people could have gone down to that valley and such, but the effect probably wouldn't have been the same, especially if there is that many Midianites and Amalekites there. So when the Bible, you know, the Bible says, you know, there are more numerous than the sands at the seashore, more numerous than locusts. So it's, you know, at some point it's
counterproductive.
Not necessarily counterproductive, but the idea is it's, you know, they're not giving us a definite number here. They're just saying there's a lot. You know, there's a lot of the Midianites and the Amalekites there. Probably more than there were the Israelites.
Well, think of it this way with the 300. It's a whole lot easier to give directions to 300 men than it is to 32,000. So the Lord has a very specific battle plan in mind. And that battle plan was not going to work with 32,000 men. You could not get 32,000 men to follow that kind of direction. And so that's part of the reason why he had to get the number down to a reasonable number, was for him to execute his plan. He needed a very small group of people. I mean, there's a, you can kind of look at it the other way. But there was an awful lot of the other guy. And those 300 men had to be exceptionally brave to be willing to go against that number with the instruction. So not only do they go down against that number, but then they have to follow those crazy instructions. Because I could just see them. So there's three groups of 100, and there's probably one captain over each group. The captain gives them the trumpet and the torch and tells them what they're doing. And the guys go, come again. What? I'm sorry. I think we misunderstood you. Can you imagine those 300 men and then them all going and doing it? I mean, that is, in some ways, more amazing to me than Gideon, because Gideon at least had the direct correspondence with God, and plus all of his tests. I know the Bible doesn't say this, but when the angel first comes to Gideon, I kind of see Gideon doing this. You talking to me? There must be some confusion here, Lord. Because Gideon was not only not a military man, but clearly his father's house had fallen pretty far for his father to have his own idol to Baal. I mean, I'm trying to put it in context of something that would mean something to us, but, you know, it would be like, you know, I started to say like me voting for Donald Trump. But it would just be really weird, you know, in the scheme of things to have something like that happen. So Gideon is exceptional in a number of ways. And you got to give the guy credit, kind of like Abraham, who keeps going back to God and saying, can we talk about that number one more time? You know, what kind of wherewithal do you have to say, now I know I tested you yesterday, but one more time to feel it. You know, that you got to give him credit for that.
God is very patient.
He knew he had the right man, clearly.
This is like Israel's first edition of special laws. The Messiah.
And to go with the idea here of I was saying about maybe less being more sometimes, I won't read the whole thing right now, but later on in 1 Samuel 14, if you're going to read it later on, Jonathan, the son of Saul, and his armor bearer take out an entire fort of Philistines. Now, Jonathan's not supposed to do that. He doesn't follow his dad in a lot of things, especially when it comes to military during that period. But him and his armor bearer are like, hey, let's go see what happens. And they say, you know, come up this way, we'll come in this way, and God's giving us it. If they say the other way, we'll just try to do something else. And they get the whole fort. And Saul's like, wait, where are you? And he's like, where are you going? Oh, just taking care of that fort you're worried about all day. But sometimes less is more than that. So with that idea, what arms do we try to face? What things do we try to face sometimes with too many things in our arsenal, per se? In other words, sometimes how do we sometimes come try to solve or do something with too much instead of the basics? You know, our trumpet, our torch, and our pitcher.
A lot of times we won't start until we have everything. So, you know, we don't want to step out in faith. I always remember that scene from the third movie, Indiana Jones, from the third Indiana Jones movie, where he has to take that step of faith onto the, what looks like into thin air, but there's actually something there, you just can't see it. So a lot of times we're not willing to do the first part because we don't have A, B, C, D, E, and F all worked out. I see that. I see that often in my own life.
And in the case, and maybe and, this might probably, this applies to, I think, almost any leap of faith. In that movie, in Indiana Jones Last Crusade, he has to take that leap, that step, because if not, his dad's going to die from that bullet wound, and, you know, in a very short amount of time. So, you know, sometimes when we're under pressure, we have to do something that we normally would want to be fully prepared for, and we have to be ourselves. You know, he doesn't have to take that step. You know, Sean Connery can, you know, pass away.
No.
He passes away between the third and fourth of the movie instead. But
I'm lucky I remember the snake pit. I've seen them all.
And that's Raiders of the Lost Ark.
I know. I'm saying the whole
she thing. She doesn't remember. She's okay. Laughing at us this week at all.
Nellie and Betty are sitting back there saying, are we talking about Judges 7?
You know who Indiana Jones is. Oh, yeah. Yes, they do. They are hip mamas.
Okay.
They know.
Well, hey, the Ark of the Covenant's in the first movie, so that applies. So, you know, the Ark of the Covenant's somewhere around at this time, so it all ties together. Okay, so, yeah, as Jay says, a lot of times we don't want to do something, so we have all our, you know, we have all our eggs in the basket, we have everything all together. And that's not always possible. At the same time, we don't want to just run head first into something without having an idea what we're doing. So in this case, yeah, it sounds crazy. God says, okay, take everyone, get them in a circle or whatever shape that will be, make the one, you know, and we go, you want me to do what? But they have the reassurance, they have the faith that even as crazy as what they're being asked to do will work. And one thing that we see in Judges, there's two things we see throughout the book of Judges, lack of faith and faith. When you have faith, amazing things happen. When you don't have faith, amazing things don't happen.
So in light of verse 23, does that mean that all of the scaredy cats were invited back?
I don't know. Let's see. The men of Israel gathered together from Naphtali, Asher, and all Manasseh and pursued the Midianites. So that's three of the 12 tribes there.
My translation says they were summoned to pursue the
maybe that was the 10,000 too.
What's that?
Maybe that was the 10,000.
Yeah, perhaps.
And the pursuit's going to last a while here. It goes on into the next chapter. And unfortunately, Gideon's children is going to turn to the dark side and do some nasty things to his brethren, but I'm trying to figure out which tribe Gideon belonged to here.
The opponents were, I mean, we use vague terms like as numerous as the sand and stuff, but chapter 8 and verse 10 talks about there were 100. For the fallen were 120,000 swordsmen. So that was a big army.
Yes.
Even had they gone with their 32,000, the odds were so, but then when you think 300 against.
So if I read this correctly, a good amount of the people within the camp kill each other just out of sheer chaos and confusion, and everyone else runs. A lot of times, when you see in the Old Testament army running, generally that means that they're not going to be battling again anytime soon, and they'll fall apart quickly. A lot of times in the Book of Kings, when armies run, their general, that their king is generally usually assassinated pretty soon thereafter too. It's a very cyclical pattern that happens there.
Gideon was from Manasseh.
Manasseh, okay, so.
The least of all the tribes, he calls it.
Which is interesting because generally, they usually consider Benjamin, usually call himself the least of all the tribes, but that was later on, so.
And Manasseh's only a half tribe.
Yes, you're right, because the other half of Manasseh is on the other side of the Jordan. Because half of Manasseh, Reuben, and one of the other tribes stayed on the other side of the Jordan when everyone else went over to the Promised Land. Now, their soldiers, their fighting men, did follow over and help conquer Canaan and then go back. We read about this in Joshua. But you're right, it's only half tribe of Manasseh.
Yeah, Ephraim and Manasseh were the sons of Joseph.
Right.
And I never quite understood what the half was all about. But
it's because Manasseh split in half. Half of them wanted to stay on one side of the Jordan, the other half wanted to go.
No, I get that, but they referred to as half tribes. Why did we just have 13 tribes?
Because the tribe of Levi does not get land as part of their inheritance in Canaan. They're not counted among the 12.
But Joseph's two sons
count, yeah. Ephraim and Manasseh.
They each get half. But I'm just saying, I was
wondering. And Ephraim far outnumbers Manasseh. Ephraim outnumbers everyone except for Judah eventually. And eventually Simeon and Benjamin are kind of pulled into Judah because Benjamin loses the tribalship around the end of Judges for reasons we won't talk about right now. It's a very, I think Sodom and Gomorrah, except maybe even worse in some ways. Then Simeon kind of just melts into Judah at some point too. And it's not really stated where, but it's just, they're kind of there, they're not all of a sudden. But.
Three tribes, Manasseh, Gad.
Yeah. Half of Manasseh, Gad, and Reuben stayed on the, stayed back in some way. And there was some controversy about that too, because I think we covered in the book of Joshua, they had set up their own mini tabernacle or synagogue and such, and that. There is almost a war over that. But that's it. That's getting back further. So, what can we take away from Gideon here in these 300? And before we get that, Jay had mentioned it is easier to command 300 men. If you've seen the 300 movie or the documentaries about it, some people prefer documentaries. It's a lot less oriented, probably a lot more realistic in some ways. The idea is that, okay, you have a small pass, you have 300 people. And you form a type of, I don't remember if it was a circle or some type of shape, perhaps with your shield. You've got your shield in one hand and your spear in the other. There, you know, it's a plan, it's definite. In theory, it should work. It worked long enough to hurt Persia, not that it worked hard enough to completely stop them. In this case here, we don't see it happening, though. In this case, because God's in control here. Say, okay, do something crazy, it will work. Because it does. And again, it's the idea that there is someone else, someone in the Midianites, who can interpret a dream that someone has as, you know, let's say, oh, the inferior is going to take us, to, you know, destroy us here. That God will give someone, give them the wisdom to understand that. That's hard for us to wrap our minds around sometimes, I think, because we think, okay, you know, you wonder whether you're going to completely surprise them, you're going to completely take them unawares, which they kind of do in some ways. But this one guy's like, yeah, there's no hope. We don't know if he stays around for the ensuing massacre or what, but.
Well, he kind of gives a clue at the beginning that he doesn't want them to take credit for it, that it's going to be a victory by God.
Right.
Lest Israel become boastful by saying, my power has delivered. Right. So I guess one of the key messages is that even with little, if God is on our side, that's significant.
Right. If you look at the battles through, if you look at numbers when the Israelites, so the Israelites go, a lot of them, 10 of the 12 spies say, okay, we're not going to say, we can't go into Canaan, there's too many giants. Well, after God gives them a stern lecture, Moses and Joshua and Caleb, they go, a bunch of them go, okay, we're not going to Canaan now. God's not with them, and they don't fare very well. In Joshua, when they go to attack Ai, or I, however you pronounce it, because Achan had sinned earlier, God's not with them. They don't fare very well. If you look at these battles, when God is with them, they are unstoppable. If he is not, they don't do well at all. And this idea continues on practically throughout the rest of the Old Testament. It's not as necessarily direct in some ways, but when you look at what happens with King Saul, I don't think God's with him in that last battle he has with the Amorites. Or is the Amorites? Someone starts with that, I believe. Because Saul loses, and so does the rest of his family.
I mean, think of Jesus just choosing 12. I mean, he could have chosen hundreds of apostles, but he just chose 12. And even after 3.5 years, you know, in Acts chapter 1, there's 120 assembled, you know, waiting for the gift of the Holy Spirit on that Pentecost after his resurrection. So that's often the message in Scripture. Don't look at what's so impressive to man. God can do great things. Think what happened with the 12 apostles and the 120, and how God bore so much fruit from that small seed.
Right in the eyes of God. But it's interesting that after 40 years of peace and the destruction of Baal, Gideon dies and they go right back to Baal. And whereas I would really like to blame Elimelech for that, you gotta wonder what they were thinking. Their lifespan was relatively decent. There were plenty of people who remembered. It says at the end of chapter 8 that they don't show kindness to the house of Gideon in accordance with all the good that he had done for Israel. So basically, they just want to set all that aside. But you do have to marvel at the ping pong game that they play, going back and forth between God and Baal. What was the draw with Baal?
Gideon kind of contributes to this before he passes away, because why he does this never makes sense to me. But it says in chapter 8, he's like, he says, like, I don't want to rule over you. I don't want to be your king. But give me your earrings and such, and that I'm going to make an ephod out of it, or some type of, I don't want to call it an idol per se, but that's what it becomes to a lot of people. And it's like, what's he doing?
But an ephod, if I remember correctly, that's something that they use to get messages from God. They would take, Terry and Mike confused.
Yeah, when it was part of the breastplate of the high priest, but I think this is a different kind of ephod. This sounded like some kind of an icon that was almost, for the life of me, and maybe somebody who has, I'm saying the same thing you are. I don't see what the attraction to Baal was.
I wonder if it wasn't just the Baal, but so many tribes around them.
We want to be like them.
And they were attracted to what people around them did and wanted.
And remember, Baal brings good crops, theoretically, if he actually functioned. They are having trouble keeping their crops. So maybe if we, because God's not listening, maybe we'll go to the calf/bull countries are worshiping him, and see if he does anything. I don't know what Israel's fascination with calves and bulls and everything before they get out, before they're, you know, by the time they're around Sinai and going on through with Jeroboam and son Nebat and everything. It's just, it's very pervasive in some ways. It's like, well, don't know what to do, so let's just worship a cow or calf.
I think people throughout the course of human history, people have had a fascination with relics, something tangible they can hold on to or bow down to. And, you know, you even see that filtering into the Catholic Church in numerous different ways, whether it's holding rosary beads or, you know, wearing the crucifix around your neck as some kind of a warding off of evil. Or anybody grow up with people that have a little statue on the dashboard? You know, was it St. Christopher? Something like that that was supposed to keep you from having a wreck and stuff. So I guess we still have remnants of some of that same mindset in a more enlightened way, but maybe it's not so much more enlightened. Good job, Stephen. Next week, I'm supposed to teach, and I might, but Ray Billers was kind of eager to teach one more chapter from John, so we might give him that spot and roll ours later on. And then after next week, I think this is... Rob, are you before the Simple Supper or after?
I think before.
Yeah, and then the Simple Supper, and then Vic Rossi has one on Acts chapter 12. And Rob, yours is on... remind me.
Exodus chapter 3.
Exodus chapter 2, the burning bush.
So Exodus 3, Acts 12. Okay, so let's see. So this Sunday, I believe we have a Covenant luncheon. It's a 4-month Sunday, right?
No. It's a rare incident where it's the same dates as February.
Yes,
four,
it is.
4-8-11.
No, yeah. That's actually true every year, except the fourth year.
Is it?
Yeah.
Late year.
Yeah, late year is the only year that it's not the same.
So the days will be the same until we get to the 29th, that exchange. And speaking of the 29th, the end of the month, we have last leaders meeting this Sunday. I will send out a text message and tell everyone to come prepared with ideas and such for the group project so we can finish that. Hopefully, Lord willing. Linda's going to be spearheading a planning meeting for any ladies that want to be start doing some group sewing and crocheting and things like that. So, yeah, lots going on this Sunday. Anything else? Okay, let's sing number 749 or 749. After this, Vic, can you do some prayer?
Yeah.
Thank you. 749.
Belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory.
of Baal worship, but it encompasses a lot of